Welcome to EMT student for discussion on analysis of results in epidemiology. Yes, please start.
Yeah, how will the results be analyzed? The main statistical methods that are going to be used to analyze the results should be defined in the study protocol. Choosing the statistical methods after the results have become available will increase the likelihood of finding association between the determinants and outcome on the basis of chance alone. An important element of analysis plan is the description of how the outcome variable is going to be analyzed.
So statistical methods are very important and are defined in the study protocol. Whatever we are studying, you are defining in the study protocol itself about the statistical methods. And the methods choosing is very important because it increases the finding the associations. So statistical methods will help in finding the association. It helps in finding the association between the determinants and outcome. Association between the determinants and outcome. So on the basis of chance alone, just by chance itself, we can just say that whether it is associated or not. The important element is how the outcome variable is going to be analyzed. So outcome analysis is very important. So outcome analysis is very important. Yes, next.
For example, a trial on early surgery for gluia that measured language development with the renal development language scales, a test of expressive language and verbal comprehension abilities in children aged 6 months to 6 years, could analyze the renal data as continuous variable. Conversely, it could define groups with normal language development and with delayed language development by dichotomizing the renal data and use this categorical variable as a main outcome measure. A categorical variable is used as an outcome measure, the denominator problem should be considered.
So as we could see that yesterday, we have seen this continuous variable and categorical variable. So continuous variable is related to more commonly about the temperature, as we have seen already. This renal, it is called as renal development language scales, especially used for GLUIA. Just remember that point. And if it could define the continuous as a continuous variable. So it is a continuous variable. As we know, we want continuous variable for clinical methods, clinical things. Okay. And if it can be used as a categorical variable also sometimes. So how do you say that? Conversely, if it could define groups with normal language development and delayed language development by dichotomizing the renal data, by making it into two, normal and delayed ones, the categorical variable can be a measure. Okay, by dichotomy, you can make it a categorical variable. Same renal score can be make a categorical variable. By dichotomy, you can make a categorical variable. This is an important point, as you could see here. So here, wherein you can use the outcome measure. So outcome is acting as a denominator problem. Outcome acts as a denominator problem. Next.
The first question asks whether the numerator is going to be included in the denominator. If answer is yes, the next question is whether the time is included in the denominator or not. Let us first consider the case where the numerator is included in the denominator, but time is not.
So numerator, denominator, as we know in mathematics, in math, you can have numerator and denominator. Next question is time. So whether time is included or not, and whether numerator is included in denominator, but time is not, that is the first type of example. Next. So this is algorithm showing the rates, proportions, and odds. So algorithm for rates, number two is proportions, number three is odds. So what is, if numerator is included, numerator with denominator, if it is included in the denomination, that is taken as yes or no. So yes or no, you take a screenshot of this one also, please. Someone take a screenshot. Chanakya can take a screenshot of this one. So and put it in the group.
Yes, answer. Sir.
If numerator is included, is yes. If S is the answer with the denominator, then you should say whether time is included or not. Time is included or not. Numerator, denominator, time. But time is yes or no. If you take that yes or no, the numerator is not included in the denominator, it becomes the odds ratio. So if numerator is not included in the denominator, it becomes the odds ratio. If numerator is included and denominator is included and time is not included, it becomes a proportion. It becomes a proportion. And if numerator is included and denominator included and time is also included, it becomes a rate. So very beautiful table is this one. You can have an idea for all the SPM. So SPM, you will be having a lot of idea about this one. So why I'm making you do this is like even when we are making a study in a department, we need the knowledge of all these things. So I'm taking the help and I congratulate this fellow, Amsi Krishna, for presenting it very well. Okay, this is a good thing. Which every medical student should be knowing. And not only that ENT, you might be thinking why ENT people are asking for SPM and all. So when we are doing a research project in a medical college, you need to have the basic idea of all these things. All things should be there in your mind. And you will be a good research fellow and then you'll be having idea. So because we have taken up a research, I thought of presenting this from ENT side also. Okay, don't think otherwise that I'm making burden for you presenting SPM in ENT. Okay, this is always a useful one for any of the medical professional. Next. So rate, proportion and odds. Rate is time is involved. Rate means numerator, denominator, time is involved. So proportion is numerator, denominator, time is not involved. Time is not involved. Odds is numerator is not numerator only there, denominator is not involved and time is also not involved. These three things should be keeping in mind. Next.
The first example of this would be a measure of the occurrence of the sensorineural hearing loss in neonates. One could simply report the proportion of neonates with hearing loss. The numerator would be number of neonates with hearing loss. The denominator would be total number of neonates included in the study. The proportion is often referred to as prevalence.
So first example of this would be the occurrence of sensorineural hearing loss in neonates. For example, SNHL in neonates, if you take that, one can report the proportion of neonates. Proportion is numerator is there, denominator is there, time is not involved. What is the proportion means? Proportion means numerator there, denominator there, time is not there. That is about the proportion as we are speaking about this one. And the numerator would be a number of neonates, for example, and the denominator would be a total number of neonates included in the study. This proportion is almost called as prevalence. This proportion can be called as prevalence. Next. The numerator equal to denominator, but time is not there. That is prevalence. Taken as prevalence. Next.
The second example would be a measure of the occurrence of head and neck cancers in people initially free of diseases. Who developed the disease within a specific period of time? The numerator would be the number of subjects who developed the disease during the follow-up. The denominator would be the total number of subjects at the beginning of the study. This proportion is often referred to as a cumulative incidence. Suppose that 1,000 smokers are followed up during a five-year period and that 15 develop head and neck cancer, the cumulative incidence would be 1.5%.
So the second thing wherein you are taking, so occurrence of head and neck cancer initially free of disease, okay, in free of disease patients, if you take it like that, the numerator is number of subjects who had developed, if you take that, and denominator is the total number of subjects, if you can take at the beginning, this proportion, this also becomes a proportion. So proportion of cumulative incidence, this can be called as cumulative incidence, wherein you are taking up for this smokers followed by five years and 15 year at the 15 develop head and neck cancer, cumulative incidence would be 1.5%. That is five people who developed in five years 15 people developed cancer in 1,000 smokers. So you can just put it as an example, 15 patients out of 1,000 patients in 5 years. So this will become 1.5% is the cumulative incidence. This is called as cumulative incidence. That you can say that in that manner. So the second point in this you have to see is the numerator would be the number of subjects who developed the disease during the follow-up, and denominator would be the total number of subjects at the beginning of the study. This is called as cumulative incidence or a proportion which is related to incidence. Previously it was, for example, sensorineural hearing loss in children, newborn, at the same period you are saying, you can call it as prevalence. Okay, next. What is incidence according to our knowledge? Incidence is the number of new cases. Okay, prevalence is number of old and new cases. Next, read. Start. Hello.
Sir,
yes. Start.
The calculation of the proportion as an estimate of disease occurrence, as described above, assumes the entire study sample has been followed up for a specific period of time. This is often not the case. Some subjects might enter the study later and other might be lost to follow up. An alternative way of measuring outcomes that takes the surveying follow-up time period into account is to include time in the denominator. The numerator would be exactly the same as for proportions, but the sum of the time that each individual was followed up and the risk of becoming a case would be used as a denominator.
So as you could see here, proportion as an estimate of occurrence of a disease. First point, it is when the sample is followed by followed up for a period of time. But every time all the people will not come back. So some people are lost in the follow up. They are called as that is called as attrition. Size of the sample is called as attrition, as you know that. Alternative way of measuring the outcomes that takes the surveying follow up. Time in the account include the denominator, include the time in the denominator. So once the follow-up is lost, so include the time in denominator. Include the time in denominator. That is one point which you can do. You can include the time in a denominator. An alternative way is to include the time in the denominator. In that case, if you are losing the patients, if attrition is present, you can use. You can do that. Time can be put in the denominator. The numerator would be exactly same as proportions, but the sum of the time each individual was followed up and risk of becoming a case would become used as a denominator. So time is used in the denominator in such cases. Next.
In this case, an incidence rate, also called as incidence density, force of morbidity or mortality hazard, could be calculated that is equal to the number of people who develop cancer divided by the total person time at risk during follow-up. For example, on the basis of the previous example of occurrence of head and neck cancers in smokers, one could have expressed the incidence rate of cancer as approximately 3 cases per 1,000 people per year, or 15 divided by approximately 5 into 1,000 years of person time at risk. Because the incidence is very low, a simple relationship holds. Cumulative incidence is equals to incidence into average follow-up time.
As you could see in this, if you are taking incidence density or force of morbidity or mortality or hazard, it is equal to number of people who develop cancer divided by total person time at the risk during follow-up. So number of people who develop cancer and based on that divided by total person time. At follow-up. So as we are saying, we want to put time in the denominator, follow-up. You can put time in the denominator. So we can use that based on the head and neck cancer example, which you have seen already. 3 cases per 1,000 per year are 15 divided by approximately 5 into 1,000 years of person risk at time. Because the incidence is very low, a simple relationship holds, like something called as if for low incidence, you can put it as cumulative incidence. Use cumulative incidence. Cumulative incidence. How do you say cumulative incidence? That is incidence into average follow-up time. So incidence into average follow-up time. Incidence into average follow-up time. Next.
Many epidemiological studies report in some form or other outcomes expressed as odds. It is important to distinguish odds from probability. A probability can be estimated as a proportion of people in whom a particular characteristic, such as presence of disease, is present. Larger the group of people under study, the better the observed proportion of people with the disease reflects the true probability.
Odds and probability, as we have seen, even the same previous this one. When numerator is not quoted with denominator and time is not used, so denominator is not there. Time is not there, then it becomes odd. what is the proportion numerator is quoted with denominator and time is not there. What is this one? Rate means numerator, denominator and time will be there. That is about the rate. So if you take the odds, that is the probability can be estimated as a proportion of population in whom a particular characteristic or presence of a disease is present. So that is probability of proportion of people with disease. You can say it as odds. So numerator present, denominator absent, time is absent. Okay, for this odds. So for odds, if you have to understand, you can take it as like the better the observed proportion of people with disease reflects the true probability. So odd, it is proportional to the true probability. So at a time, you are not using any time in this. So once if you take prevalence, incidence and true probability, so prevalence is linked to your this particular rate, that is about the numerator and denominator and time, and this incidence is linked to this proportion. Incidence is linked to your proportion, and then odds is linked to your true probability. Okay, so if time is there, then you can say you have what is true probability. Time is not there, numerator is not there, and denominator is not there. Numerator only there, then you can say true probability. I'm sorry. So nothing is there except numerator, then it is true probability. Next.
Odds, on the other hand, represent the ratio of two complementary probabilities. For example, if probability of a disease is 0.20, then the odds are 0.20% by 0.80. That is 1:4. That is 0.25. Another way of calculating the odds is by dividing the number of subjects with a characteristic by the number without it. In other words, numerator is not included in the denominator.
So as we have already seen, numerator is there, denominator not there, time is not there. It is odds, which tells us about the something relevant to the true probability. Numerator there, denominator there, time not there, you can go for prevalence. Numerator there, denominator there, then you can go for incidence. As you could see in this example, it represents the ratio of two complementary probabilities. So complementary probabilities, odds. So you can say that odds ratio. Normally what we say, we call it as odds ratio. It's also called as odds ratio, AD by BC, as you've seen in the case control study. Is it or not? Odds ratio says two complementary probabilities. Two complementary probabilities. Okay. The probability of disease is 0.2, then odds are 0.20% by 0.80. So 1:4 is 0.25. So as you take, for example, probability of disease is 0.2, you can just divide it by 100, that is 20%, and becomes 20, and no probability of disease will become 80, that becomes 1:4, it becomes 0.25. The other way of calculating the odds is dividing the number of subjects with the characteristic number without it. So in other words, it is not included in the denominator. So numerator is not equal to denominator. So numerator is not included in the denominator, then you can call it as odds. Just blindly remember that numerator, denominator and time is there. Is about the rate. Numerator present, denominator present, time is not there. That is about the proportion. Numerator is never equivalent to denominator and time is never there, then it is odds. That's it. Next.
Most frequently, it is not the odds itself that is reported in epidemiological studies, but the odds ratio, the ratio of odds in different groups. This can be the outcome odd ratio, or the ratio of the odds of the outcome of interest in the group with the determinants to the odds of the outcome in the group without the determinant. Conversely, these can also be the determinants odds ratio, or the odds of the determinant in the group with the outcome compared to the odds of the determinant in the group without the outcome of interest.
Okay, when you're taking that, instead of odds, so odds is related to numerator is never equivalent to denominator and time is not there, that is odds. Odds is not used directly in epidemiology. Our studies, we use the odds ratio. use the odds ratio. Odds ratio is better. And second word, what he is telling, the author is telling is odds, outcome odds ratio. So outcome odds ratio is a better thing. Outcome odds ratio is a better thing. A ratio of odds of the outcome of the interest group is determined to the odds of the outcome of the group without the determinant. So determinant and occurrence is one which calculate in epidemiology, is it or not? Determinant and occurrence relationship, EO relationship, we have been calculating. So with the determinant and without determinant, when you say this can outcome odds, this can be called as outcome odds ratio, or otherwise it is also called as determinant odds ratio. Determinant odds ratio. This is the determinant odds ratio, which can be compared to the odds of the determinant group without determinant and with the determinant. So with the determinant and without determinant, and numerator is not equal to denominator, and time is not there. That is about the odds ratio, as you know. Next.
One reason why epidemiologists find odds ratio so attractive is that outcome odds ratio are equivalent to determinant odds ratio, which is a fact used in analysis of case control studies. For example, presents the fictitious findings of a study on risk factors for post-operative complications of tonsillectomy. The outcome odds ratio is same as the determinant odds ratio, which can be easily understood as both odds ratio simplified to the cross product of the cell frequencies of 2:2 table.
So you can say 2:2 table cross product AD/BC, as we see AD/BC. This is very simple, and fortunately this outcome odds ratio matches with our case control study. Okay, next. So in this, you could see, so when you take outcome odds ratio and determinants odds ratio, fictitious example of complication rates after tonsillectomy. So you take the post-operative complication like this. So you can take a picture of this. Once again, Chanakya can take a screenshot of this. We'll share in the group once again. So bipolar, yes, diathermy and other methods. So bipolar diathermy, yes. Bipolar diathermy is not used, no. So instrument used are bipolar. This is bipolar method of dissection of tonsillectomy. So I was telling you that tonsil will be covered in the next class in the theory and at the college, is it or not? So we'll be dissecting, telling about the dissection snare method, bipolar, all the methods we'll be discussing then. So bipolar diathermy, whether it is used or not. So A, B, yes or no you'll be putting, and A plus B is 300. Other methods, 24, C, this is 606, D, this is 700D. So when we get to C, A plus C and B plus D, yes or no, you're into one group and no is one group. So when you take the cross product, you can take it as AD/BC. That is a cross product as you see in SPM. So this is a method we compare the things after tonsillectomy as a case control study. Next. So outcome odds ratio can be calculated as you could see. Outcome odds ratio is very important. I think you can take this one also as a screenshot. So outcome odds ratio can be, outcome odds ratio can be calculated as, you can write down also this one. Even I am also writing down right now. So as we know in SPM, A/A+B divided by B/A+B whole divided by C/C+D divided by D/C+D. So A/B/C+D you are taking it as. So you can take it as A/B or C/D, which is AD/BC. So this is the final one, which is AD/BC is very important. This is outcome odds ratio. Next is determinant odds ratio. So determinant odds ratio. Determinant odds ratio. How do you take it? So determinant odds ratio is A/A+C divided by C/A+C by B/B+D divided by D/B+D. So at the end it becomes A/C/B/D. Once again becomes AD/BC. The same value is coming for outcome odds ratio and determinant odds ratio. So outcome odds ratio and determinant odds ratio. To go back once, please put the other slide also. I'll just note it down also. So once you take, so anything is there, yes or no you'll be putting, and total you'll be putting. So any factor, so factor one, is factor two. You can write down as factor one and factor two, and you can write down as total. So you can write down as total. So S is A, no is B. Other is S is B, C, no is D. So totally, the total is A plus B here, C plus D here. So here total will be A plus C and B plus D. So this is a simple table. Everyone can remember it very easily. Even for your NEET entrance examination also, it is very important. So you have to know about this epidemiology. Definitely, there is no other option. Sometimes you will get questions on this. A by A plus B. So as you could see, A by A plus B by B by A plus B, C by C plus D by D plus D is equal to AD by BC. At the end of the day, you will get AD by BC. Okay, next. So both outcome odds ratio and this determinant odds ratio are coming to be similar. Next.
When dichotomous outcome variable is used, for example, arrive or dead, or disease present or absent, risk differences and risk ratios are commonly used as a measure of effect. The risk in this circumstance can represent prevalence, cumulative incidence, or even odds, as described above. One might ask, what is the additional risk of head and neck cancers in people who smoke over and above that in people who do not? The answer to this question is obviously a risk difference.
So you can say dichotomous outcome variable when alive or dead, disease outcome ratio, that is for alive or dead, you can just say in this situation, you can go for risk differences or risk ratios and measures the effect. Measures of effect also can be done. So when you take risk in this, so what happens? It can be a prevalence or cumulative incidence or incidence or odds. Cumulative incidence or odds as described above. So we have to ask about what is the additional risk of head and neck cancer in people who smoke over and above the people who do not. So that is obviously a risk difference. So what is risk difference? So is head and neck cancer not there in non-smokers? Definitely not. It is there, surely there. So risk difference is head and neck cancer in smokers and non-smokers. Example is smokers and non-smokers. Next.
In a previous fictitious example, we suppose that we followed up 1,000 smokers for a period of 5 years and that we will find that 15 of them developed head and neck cancers. The cumulative incidence of cancer in this group is therefore 1.5%. We can also suppose that we did the same in 1,000 non-smokers and that we found cancer in 7 of them. The cumulative incidence in non-smokers is 0.7%.
So you should know about the cumulative incidence in smokers and non-smokers. Example is cumulative incidence in smokers and non-smokers. Smokers and non-smokers. Okay, next.
The risk difference attributable to smoking is therefore 0.8%. On the other hand, one might ask, how many times are smokers more likely to get head and neck cancer compared to non-smokers? Following our example, we could calculate the risk ratio as 2.1. That is 1.5% by 0.71%. In other words, smokers are approximately twice as likely to develop head and neck cancer over a 5-year period. The risk ratio does not tell us anything about the magnitude of the risk difference.
So two concepts like risk difference and risk ratio, RD and RR. So there is no triple R here, RD and RR, risk ratio only. Okay, so what is that? Risk difference is between the two risks, non-smokers minus smokers. So smokers minus non-smokers, you can put it as like that, non-smokers. You can put it as like this, smokers minus non-smokers. And the other hand, how many times the smokers are likely to get? So that is about the risk ratio. So how many times the smokers have a chance? How many times smokers have a chance? Smokers have a chance. That is a risk ratio. You can just say that. And third point, as you could see, twice as likely. So smoking leads to twice chances. Twice chances, that is 1.5 by 0.7. You can just almost double. So risk ratio does not tell anything about the magnitude, but of the risk difference. Next.
Even for large risk ratios, the risk difference might be quite small if the outcome is uncommon. As a rule of thumb, risk differences are more meaningful as a measure of effect in clinical situations because it represents the actual additional probability in those exposed. On the other hand, relative risks are more meaningful as effect measures of causal relationship in etiological studies.
Causal relationship, not casual. So what do you say? First point is large risk ratios. The risk difference might be small. The outcome is uncommon. The outcome is uncommon. So large risk ratios, the risk difference might be quite small if the outcome is uncommon. So as a rule, the risk differences are more meaningful as a measure of effect of clinical situation. So risk differences is more proportional to clinical scenarios. Clinical scenarios, you can just say that, and represents the additional probability. It represents the additional probability. So it is RD that is more important. It tells us about the additional probability. It tells us about the additional probability. And relative risks are more meaningful as effective measures of causal. So RR tells us about the causal relationship. So causal relationship. So the relationship is told by RR. RRR, you can just say. RR tells about the relationship, that is about the etiological factor. You can remember RRR here. Next.
How large is the study going to be? A major problem of many studies is that the study size is too small. Small studies lead to impressive results. Some small studies often increase rather than reduce scientific and clinical uncertainty in a specific area. Although one might argue that small studies have a role of their own because they might be included in a systemic review and meta-analysis, which would mimic the results of larger study. It should be the goal of every study to include a number of checks that would itself produce meaningful results.
So, thank you for participating in the end, students. This part will be done in the next class.